Hey, Harvest. We're so glad to have you with us this weekend watching online. My name is Lynn. I'm from the Elgin campus, and I'm so glad to be your online host this weekend. You know what else? We would love to have you just put in the chat role there where you're watching from. It's kind of fun to see who's watching from where. And on deck this weekend is Pastor Tommy. He's going to bring to us a message from our series, The Road to Reality. It's from the book of Romans. And you know, I can't help but think just what a timely series in the context of our crazy world today. So, Pastor Tommy, thank you so much for all you do for us and for your labor of love. I know that you've worked hard to get ready to teach us this weekend, and we're anxious and ready. Well, hey, if you haven't followed Harvest Bible Chapel yet on social media, can I encourage you to do that today? You can find us on Facebook, on Instagram, on YouTube. It's a great way to just stay connected and kind of just watch what God is doing here. So the YouTube channel is actually kind of fun because you can go back and watch previous services on there. So check out youtube.com/Harvest Bible Chapel Chicago. Will you join me now as we head into worship?
We worship a God that finishes what he starts. We're going to sing about that now, that he is not done yet. Let's lift our voice. Come on.
God of the promise, God of the future, you see beginning and end. God of the rescue, God of the breakthrough, how great is your faithfulness? You're not done yet.
No eye.
No eye has ever seen. No ear has ever heard. No one could ever comprehend. Your word will be enough. Your promise we will trust. Greater things are still ahead. Song in my soul. God in the working. God, I'm believing. You'll do the impossible. You're not done yet. No, no. No eye has ever seen. No ear has ever heard. No one could ever comprehend. Promise we will trust. Greater things are still ahead. You're not done yet. You're not done yet.
You're up.
You're up to something right now. You're doing God, let your glory come down. Don't hold back, don't hold back. You're up to something right now. You're doing a new thing right now. God, let your glory come down. Don't hold back, don't hold back. You're moving back.
that just the greatest news ever, that God is not done yet? I cling to that so often. Well, we just want to welcome you. So glad you're with us on our online service here this weekend. My name is Lynn, and I'm so honored to be your online host. So glad you're with us. And, you know, I just want to say, if you're visiting with us for the first time, a special welcome to you. We're sending just welcome through the airwaves and hope that you come back next weekend as well. And whether you're new or whether you've been here for a long time like me, we would appreciate so much if you would just take a second and check in. You can do that right on your Harvest app. You can do that right at the top of your screen. We love to know that you're here and just appreciate knowing any of your prayer requests as well. So feel free to put those in. And I just want to take a second to just thank all of you who are faithful givers. The Lord's just so honored with your gifts, and we appreciate that so much. And we encourage you to keep giving as the Lord leads you, and want to make sure you know there's four ways. You can give with just the Harvest app. You can give online at the Harvest website. You can give through a text, and you can also send in your gift to the Rolling Meadows office through the snail mail. So we just appreciate it. Well, I can't believe I'm standing here and going to talk to you about Thanksgiving, and the holidays are here already, but our campuses have just been busy getting ready to serve the community, to serve our people in a variety of ways. So if you would like to help and be part of the serving, let us know, or if you need some help this Thanksgiving, we'd also like to know that. You can go to harvestnow.info and have everything you need right there. Well, we're talking about Thanksgiving, but I'm excited to also say the young adults are talking about Friendsgiving. They're going to have a special get-together on Thursday, November 19th. This is an all-campus thing. It's going to be at the Rolling Meadows campus, but it's for everyone from all the campuses. There's going to be lots of worship, lots of fellowship, and I hear there's going to be a ton of pie. Yes, apple, pecan, pumpkin, whatever. So I hope that you can find everything you need on harvestnow.info for that information. Would you pray with me now? Almighty Heavenly Father, the chaos in our world is confusing and consuming. The desperation of our day is daunting, but we're here today because we know that you are God, and you are on the throne, and you are the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. So we come to you today with great praise and great acknowledgement that nothing's too hard for you, nothing's too far from you, nothing is impossible. And we look to you. Help us to shift our focus to you, Lord, away from our fears and on to you. Make us a church, Lord, that sets our gaze on you. We love you, Lord. Would you receive these gifts? Build our church. Build it in your way, Lord, to your glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Spirit of the living God, Spirit of the living God, we only wanna hear your voice, we're hanging on every word. Spirit of the living God, Spirit of the living God, we wanna know you more and more, we're hanging on every word. 'Cause when you speak, and when you move, when you do what only you can do, it changes us, it changes what we see and what we seek. And when you come in the room, when you do what only you can do, it changes us, it changes what we see and what. Spirit of the living God, Spirit of the living God, we're leaning into all you are, and everything else can wait. Yes. Spirit of the living God, Spirit of the living God, come now and breathe upon our hearts, come now and have your way. 'Cause when you speak, and when you move, and when you do,
sing praise to Him. Sing out your praise to Him. Sing praise to Him. Sing out your praise to Him. Wherever you are, sing praise to Him. Sing out your praise. Lift it up to Him.
Your sting, our resurrected.
with praise. Let our hopes be filled with praise. Let our hopes be filled with praise today. Let our hopes be filled with praise to Him. We sing. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. The Lamb has overcome.
Thank you.
We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah.
Why? Come on.
The Lamb is overcome. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. We sing hallelujah. 'Cause the Lamb is overcome. We sing hallelujah. Yes, we sing hallelujah. And we sing hallelujah.
Because
Well, hey, church, it is good to be back with you again.
A lot has happened since the last time I was up here 3 weeks ago. We had an election, or maybe we have an election is the better term for it, because it is seemingly still going on. COVID seems to be spiking again, and with it new recommendations and the possibilities of going back phases, it seems that our realities have changed in just a short amount of time. And at some point in the past few weeks, I was really unsure which reality I was living in. Who's going to be the next president? What is happening with COVID? What is happening in our world? And maybe you've thought that way over the past few weeks as well, not understanding what exactly our reality is or is going to be. And that can be a very unnerving place to be. It can be a very anxious place to be. That could be a place that brings confusion and all of the emotions that come with that. So today, we are going to bring clarity to a reality in our life. That way, we have no confusion about it and the effects on us. Today, we're going to be talking about the reality of sin. The reality of sin. We're going to be in Romans 6, 12 through 14. And maybe you thought it was going to be something more uplifting. Maybe. Don't worry. It is. Today, we're going to be looking at the reality of sin in our life. And no matter where you are at with the Lord, we're going to see the reality of sin's effect on us. But I want to start off with 5 points that I want us to write down and to remember as we're walking through Romans 6 together. I want you to write these down and remember these as we're walking through Romans 6. I got these from Dr. V, and I couldn't possibly have phrased them any better. So here they are. The first one, sin is a force leading non-Christians to resist God. Sin is also personified as a slave master or a king. I was positionally, spiritually, judicially, and really united with Christ in his death on the cross. When I died with him, I died with special reference to sin as a master over me. And I am free from the absolute domination of sin. Write these down right now. Maybe if you want to, you could take out your phone and just take a picture of it if that's a little bit easier. We're gonna keep them up just a little bit longer so that you can write these down if you're writing. And I think these points are crucial to have and to keep as we are walking through the message today. You see, sin is no small topic. And today we're gonna be diving into Romans 6, 12 through 14 specifically, but I am going to try my hardest to bring the fullness of chapter 6 to bear in my assignment to preach the word to us today. So let's look at it. Romans 6, 12 through 14. This is our text for today. Let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body to make you obey its passions. Do not present your members to sin as instruments for unrighteousness, but present yourselves to God as those who have been brought from death to life, and your members to God as instruments for righteousness. For sin will have no dominion over you, since you are not under the law, but under grace. Romans 6, 12 through 14. We are looking at the reality of sin. And the first reality is this. You were a slave to it. That's the first reality. You were a slave to it. Look at verse 12. It says, let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body to make you obey its passions. Let not sin therefore, now listen, we always have to stop at the therefores and figure out what's that therefore. It's a reference back to verse 1 through 11, and I'm going to summarize this for us. But because we have been united into the death, burial, and resurrection with Christ, our old self has been put to death so that sin may no longer enslave us. Verse 7 says, for the one who has died has been set free from sin. And we have died with him, and we also live with him in newness of life. So verse 11 says, so you must also consider yourself dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. Well, verse 6 and 7 shows us that there was a time that we were enslaved to sin, where it was reigning over our mortal bodies. Before we were united with Christ, we were a slave to sin. This is true of you. This was true of me. This was our reality before Christ. You were a slave to sin, meaning that it reigned over you. It was your master. It was your king. It made you to obey its passions. You were unable to overcome it. You stood no chance against its temptations. Its enticement was complete. You were a slave. And when you were a slave to sin, there were simply sins that you could not say no to. You were obligated to obey them. You might have shirked them off for a moment, but you could never fully resist. You could never have actual victory over it because that's what was in your heart before you were given a new heart by Jesus Christ and regenerated by the Holy Spirit. So why are we focusing on sin and being a slave to it? Paul here in Romans is writing to Christians, and I think that I'm probably speaking to a majority of Christians as well. So why take the time to walk through something that is no longer true of us? Here's why. It is of great importance that we know about sin. Not just what it is by definition, which is not obeying the law of God and rebellion against God. It's not just knowing about it, but here it is. Do we truly understand our condition? Do we know about this condition that we have that required the death and resurrection of Jesus on the cross to save us from it? How depraved we are that it required God in human form to die as a sacrifice in our place to rescue us from its effect. Do we truly understand the depth of our sin? The truth is, we need to have a better theology of sin. We need to have a greater understanding of sin, not just in a knowledge sense, but in a very real sense, in myself, in me, the depravity that I once was living in. The grievous nature of my unrighteousness towards God, the filthiness that I believed was good but was as dirty rags to the Lord, the destruction that was in my heart, the death that was coming out of my heart through action spurred on by selfish desire and self-pleasure, the rejection of truth and fullness of my embrace of sin. Because when I do, when I understand that, the depth of my sin, I will then have a greater understanding of salvation, of justification, of grace, of sanctification, of redemption. Only when we understand the depths of our sin do we truly understand the height of God's love for us. Because while we were still sinners, enemies to God, Christ died for us and showed us his great love. We come to this greater understanding of the greatness of his love when we understand the depth of our sin. You only understand how great something is when you have something truly awful to compare it with. Let me illustrate. Okay, this is a Shake Shack burger. Right here. What I would consider, maybe I'm alone on this, I don't know, it doesn't matter. I consider this to be one of the greatest burgers, okay? Now, if I had only ever had this burger, which looks, it's taking every ounce of willpower not to take a bite of this right now. This is great. But if I only ever had this burger, I would think it was pretty good. It's a pretty good burger. Tastes really nice. I like what it does. Tastes good. And I would think that this is a good burger, if this is the only burger that I ever had. But then we have this burger coming into the mix. Right here. This is White Castle. Look at that. That is truly disgusting. Okay, I don't know if you've ever had one of those. Oh, no, I can't even do that. But when we take a bite of this depravity, we understand all the more how good and great and wonderful the Shake Shack burger is. We understand it. We see it. Now I can rightly see the goodness and glory of Shake Shack because I have tasted the disgusting nature of White Castle. And in the same way, when I realize the depth of my sin, how terrible it is, how terrible my sin is, it illuminates and reveals the height of the goodness of God and His saving power in my life. My worship of God increases as the reality of my sin becomes more clear. That's why we're talking about this. So if you have made a decision for Christ to be your Savior, and this was your reality, you were a slave to sin, I would encourage you right now to really examine and come to a great understanding of what sin is and was in your life and the depth of it and the depravity of it so that you can all the more glory at the goodness of God and see the height of His great power and love for you. And maybe you're here and you haven't made a decision for Christ. And this is your reality now. You are a slave to sin. Can I just tell you that you can come to Him right now in faith for the forgiveness of your sins, to admit to Him, I am this. I'm a sinner, and I'm a slave to it. But I believe in You, Jesus. I believe You are who You say You are, the Son of God. I believe You did what You say You did. You died on the cross for my sin, and You were raised to life, defeating sin and death. Believe that. Confess your sin to Him right now. And you could be saved. You can have this new reality that we're going to talk about. Because when we do that, when we have salvation, we have a new reality towards sin. Here's the second thing. Here's the other reality. You are freed from it. You are freed from it. Look at verse 13. It says, "Do not present your members to sin as instruments for unrighteousness, but present yourselves to God as those who have been brought from death to life, and your members to God as instruments for righteousness." We no longer have to present our members to sin as instruments for unrighteousness, which just simply means that we are not presenting our whole bodies, our members, to sin as tools for unrighteousness. We're not being used by sin as tools for unrighteousness, which is the constant state of the unbeliever's life. That's no longer true of us. We don't have to live that way any longer. Instead, we now have power over sin. It no longer reigns over us. It no longer dominates us. We are no longer a slave to it. We can present our whole bodies to God for righteousness because we have been brought from death to life. Because of the glorious salvation that is found in Jesus Christ, we have been freed from the slavery of sin, freed from the mastery of sin, free from the domination of sin, freed from sin reigning over our lives. But not only freed from death, but also brought into abundant and wonderful and eternal life. Some would say hallelujah. It's amazing. And we can now live as instruments for righteousness. We can present our whole bodies to God as tools for righteousness, something that was impossible before. In our sinful condition, we could do no good, no righteousness. Something radically needed to happen, and that radical thing is salvation. And now because of salvation in Christ, we have been freed from the shackles of sin and can be used for righteousness. I have asthma, and as a person who has asthma, that means that there are some times in my life when I, sometimes if I laugh too hard or if I start running or doing some sort of working out, or maybe I just sneeze, something happens in my body where I have something called an asthma attack. And what it feels like is like, if you can imagine breathing through like a coffee straw, and that's the only amount of air that you get, it kind of feels like that. It feels a bit like you're suffocating a little bit. That's what an asthma attack feels like. And I remember one time that I ran out of my emergency inhaler. I ran out of medicine. And I had an attack, of course. Like, obviously, of course, in that moment, I would have an asthma attack. And I remember so firmly just being powerless, just being completely and totally powerless. I remember looking up online ways and home remedies to try and get me out of this asthma attack. I remember doing crazy things. I remember trying to just control my breathing, right? Like deep breaths in and out, and that didn't work. And so I moved on to the next thing. I turned on the shower, turned it all the way up onto hot, and tried to have the steam from the shower and breathe that in and calm down my lungs. That didn't help at all. I remember going out into my car. It was about 1 o'clock in the morning, and I remember turning on the air conditioning and just putting my face in front of it, breathing in the air-conditioned air, because the internet said that that would work. They were wrong, and that didn't work. Then I decided that I would use essential oils, which, if you know anything about me, like, I have to be pretty desperate to get to the place where I'm putting essential oils on my body or drinking them. Nothing helped. Nothing that I did could save me from my condition. I was having an attack, and I could not do anything myself. There was one radical thing that could change my reality in that moment. It was my medicine. It was albuterol. So I finally gave up trying to do it myself. I went to the emergency room at 2 a.m, and I took a dose from my inhaler, and literally within seconds, the attack was gone. I was breathing normally. It went away. There was only one way to get me out of this suffering reality and to a life-giving reality, and it was my medicine. It was my medicine. That is salvation in our life. One way, through Jesus, to change our reality from slave to sin to free in Christ. This is a brand new reality for us, and it is as different from the light is from the darkness. Before, I couldn't know God. Now I can through Christ. Before, I couldn't do good. Now I can through Christ. Before, I couldn't have true hope. Now I can through Christ. Before, I couldn't have true peace. Now I can through Christ. Before, I couldn't have true joy. Now I can through Christ. Before, I couldn't be fulfilled. Now I can through Christ. Before, I couldn't pay the penalty of sin. Now it's paid by Christ. Before, I rejected the truth. Now I can know it through Christ. Before, I was dead. Now I have life in Christ. Before, I had no victory. Now I have it in Christ. Before, I couldn't be free. Now I have freedom in Christ. Now that we have believed in Jesus Christ and have come to salvation by grace through faith, we have freedom. Now we are being sanctified. I'm no longer a slave to self-pleasure, but I am drawn toward holiness in Christ. I am free from the shackles of sin. So what should this reality bring about in our hearts? What should this reality bring about in our hearts? Well, it for sure should bring about praise. God, thank you. You are amazing that you would love me, a sinner, an enemy, enough to send your son, Jesus, to die for me, and that you would make a way for me to have a relationship with you. How great is your love? How great is your mercy? How great is your grace? How great is your power? It should inspire praise in our hearts. Should lead us towards obedience. I don't have to live as a slave any longer. I can obey God. I can be used as a tool for righteousness. I don't want to live that life anymore. I want to live as unto God because of what he did for me. It brings about hope in our heart. hope. We have an eternal security through Jesus Christ. I am no longer a slave. I have been freed. And the power that freed me from slavery still lives within me. I have great hope for the future. Should bring about encouragement. Encouragement. No matter how depraved I was, and I was, how far from God I was, He has brought me out of that and into life with Him. And because I have the Spirit within me, I have God with me, I am no longer a slave to sin. I can overcome the sin in my life through the power of God in me. And it should bring about a desire for God. God, I want to spend more time with you. I want to know you more. I want to know more about the richness of who you are. I want to spend time in your word. I want to spend time in conversation and prayer. I want to spend time worshiping your name. I desire more of you, God. These are the things that this reality should bring about in our hearts. And what an amazing reality that we have. Amen. But here's the thing. Some of us are not living that reality out. Here's the third and final thing for us. You have a choice to make. You have a choice to make. Look at verse 14. For sin will have no dominion over you, since you are not under law, but under grace. This is a promise right here. For sin will have no dominion over you, since you are not under the law, meaning the whole law of God. The law, which commands and demands, pronounces judgment, pronounces condemnation when it is violated, exposes and convicts of sin. But the law cannot justify a person who has violated or broken the law. It cannot release a person from the bondage of sin. But grace is the power of God, and it can do all of the things that the law could not. And we are transferred from being under the law to being under grace. We are no longer under the law, which has jurisdiction over the living, because we have died with Christ and have received grace. We are justified before the Lord through His grace. This is a great and hopeful proclamation and promise of freedom by Paul. The reality is we have been freed. Sin will have no dominion over us. But some of us don't live in that reality. Because although we are free from the domination of sin, the mastery of sin, the enslaving nature of sin, here's the reality. Sin's influence on us and on our life is still around. Temptation, the flesh, the world, the devil, trying to influence us to put the shackle back on, to return to sin, to not live in the victory that we have, to not live in the promise that we have, to go back to sin as a dog who returns to his vomit. So the reality is, if you have been freed, but some of us still choose to live like a slave. You are a slave to the thing that you obey, the rest of Romans 6 says. You're a slave to the thing that you obey. And some of us choose to continue to obey sin. Sin which leads to death. And when we choose to live like this, we receive the same earthly consequences, natural consequences as the unbeliever. Misery, shame, suffering. Maybe you didn't know that even though you are saved, freed from sin, when you choose to obey sin and live like a slave, your consequences look no different than that of an unbeliever here on earth. Sure, your eternity looks different. You have been secured in Christ, but your life here and now is death, shame, misery, and suffering. That's what it promises. Those are the fruits of sin. But we have power over sin now. We are freed from and can choose instead to obey righteousness, which leads to the fruits of the Spirit. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. It leads to sanctification, holiness, and it leads to the abundant life. Wow, that seems a whole lot better, doesn't it? Seems a whole lot better. Miles and miles better. But even though that's true, we still choose this. Why? Why do we choose sin? Maybe it's because we don't believe the promise. We don't believe the promise. We don't believe that sin doesn't have dominion over us anymore, that it's not reigning over us. Do you know how long I've been stuck in this sin? Do you know how long, how far, how deep this is ingrained in me? This thing has complete control over me. Maybe you still think that. Maybe you believe that. Maybe it's because we choose the path of least resistance. Living the Christian life is hard. Making the choice in obeying righteousness is hard. It requires suffering or sacrifice. It requires much from us. Sin is easy. It's my pleasure, my self-gratification. There's not a lot of resistance down the road to sin. Feels pretty inviting, actually. Maybe it's because we don't rely on the power of God. We try to do it in our own strength. I can overcome this sin. I can do it. Listen. That's foolishness. The whole thing is you couldn't do it before. You couldn't do it by yourself. The thing that has changed is not your strength, but the power of God in your life. You still can't do it on your own, but you can through the power of God. But we don't rely on the power of God. Another reason why we choose to sin is because we want pleasure now. We live in a world of instant gratification. I want pleasure, and I want it now. I don't want to wait for the goodness that comes through living a life of obedience to God. Sanctification, what a long process that is to get to the good. I'll settle for this right now. I can have it right now. 2 o'clock in the morning, I could go and get it. Self-gratification. Here's the good news. We have been freed from the absolute domination of sin. And therefore, we no longer have to live that way. Will it be difficult? Yes. But it will be worth it. God has given us righteousness freely in Christ Jesus, which leads us to becoming more like Christ. And we can choose righteousness over sin. We must choose righteousness over sin. So here it is, the reality of our life. You can find yourself in one of these three chairs, these three different realities. The first is the slave to sin, unsaved, never made a decision for Christ. You're slave to sin. It is reigning over you. It is your master, your king. Maybe you find yourself in this chair. Maybe you find yourself here, freed from sin. You have believed on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. You have believed in your heart and confessed with your mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord, and you have been saved. And in that moment, you have been freed. And you have chosen to live for righteousness, to present your whole body to God as a tool for righteousness' sake, to be obedient, living according to His will and word. Maybe you find yourself here. Or maybe you find yourself here, freed, but living as a slave. And I just want you to place yourself in one of these three chairs. Where is your reality right now? Where are you? Are you here, slave to sin? Are you freed from sin? Are you freed but living as a slave? Where are you? Which reality is true of you? Because here's the thing, depending on where you are, there's something different for each of us here. We talked about this one just a little while ago. To go from the reality of being a slave to sin to being free, it requires salvation found only through Jesus Christ. And you can get that right with Him now. Right now. You do not have to wait any longer. Admit to Him that you are a sinner. I have sinned. I have fallen short of the glory of God. I am a slave to this. I need a Savior, and that Savior is Jesus Christ. I believe you are who you say you are, that you are the Son of God. I believe that you did what you say you did, that you died on the cross for my sin. You took my place. You paid the price, and you rose again, defeating sin and death. And I put my trust and my faith in you alone for my salvation. That'll change your reality to free. Maybe you find yourself here, freed from sin. Listen, I just want to encourage you. Keep going. You're living for righteousness. It's hard. It is worth it. Persevere. Continue. Keep going. Be encouraged. Praise the Lord that He has freed you from sin. Don't lose sight of the amazing power and love that is. He has freed you. Keep going. Be encouraged. And if you find yourself here, freed but living as a slave, be reminded of your reality. Be reminded of the promise. You are free. You are free from the dominion of sin. It has no power over you. It is no longer your master. And maybe you feel that way because you have been walking away from God for a long time. And you think, I am so far gone. I've been down this path for far too long. I'm in too deep. Remember, it does not hold dominion over you. And all you need to do is turn to God. Confess your sin. The Bible says He is faithful and just to forgive us our sin and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. That promise is for you. Sin is not your master. God is your master. We are His sons and daughters. Our identity, our reality has changed. Stop living in the reality of the old man. Live in the newness, the new reality that God has given to us. And so, I want to just open up some space right now. Wherever you're at, whichever chair you find yourself in, right now, wherever you're watching,
take a posture towards the Lord of humility, of praise, of need. Maybe that's kneeling down. Maybe that's on your face. Maybe that's standing up with your arms raised high in praise. Maybe it's sitting and contemplating. But go to the Lord right now. Wherever you're sitting, talk with Him. Be with Him. Do the work that you need to do in this moment, right now.
God, yes I am who I am.
Thank you for your word. Lord, we thank you for your power. We thank you for the freedom that we experience through having salvation in Jesus Christ alone. And Lord, thank you for the reality that we are no longer slaves. You have freed us. Help us to walk with you, Lord. Give us courage to make the decisions that we need to make this week. Help us to confess what we need to confess. Help us to do the work, Lord. It is your power in us, not us. So, Lord, we need you. We love you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. It's been great worshiping with you today, going through God's word, singing his praise. Listen, I want you to know this week, all right? You are loved.